Be sure to check out the 80 Slasher Librarian merch store. All kinds of items, all kinds of designs, any color and size you want. The link to the merch store is in the description below. Use the promo code 10OFF for 10% off your purchase. Tonight's upload is brought to you by our patrons on the Patreon page. That's Alleyway, Bonanza Jellybean, Bree, Carl Eakin, Cecilia Spears, Allison Seib, Hawaii, Iron Alexa, Catherine McClear, Kristen K., Lauren Vaught, Liam Anderson, Michael, Ryan Woodward, Sean Campbell, and William Schaefer. Thank you all so much for supporting the channel on Patreon. And if you would like to support the channel through Patreon, click the link in the description below. Depending on the tier you select, you can get things such as free ebooks every month, a role in audiobook narrations, free merch, and so much more. Patreon tiers start as low as $2 to $5 per month. Also, in the description below, you'll find a link to our Facebook group page, our Twitter account, and our subreddit. And now, enjoy tonight's narration.
He said, "Hi there, ain't I lucky? Pleased to meet you. Call me Chucky. I'll always be your very bestest friend. You know, pals are hard to come by, but you'll find that I'm a good guy who'll stick with you until the very end." Then, much to my surprise, he rolled his head and he blinked his eyes. So I took him home to be my very own, and things were really going swell, till my auntie slipped and fell, and Chucky laughed and said, "Now we're alone."
C-H-U-C-K, why'd you come out and play?
Listen up, fool, I'll tell you why, 'cause Chucky's bad, that ain't no lie.
Chucky, Chucky, go away, you're too rough when you play.
Over in the corner, peek-a-boo, honey, honey, ha. Warned of danger, and Chucky said that he was really bugged, 'cause it isn't very funny being treated like a dummy. So I went and gave that little guy a hug, but he pushed me away and said, "I'm sick of this child's play. No more Mr. Good Guy from now on." Then I got really scared, 'cause he jumped straight up in the air and laughed and started cursing up a storm.
Child's Play 3, the novelization of the film by Matthew Costello. Chapter 4. The string of Sullivan's good guy yo-yo became tangled. The yo-yo didn't unwind as smoothly as it should, and Sullivan reminded himself to send out a memo in the morning. Check the yo-yos. "We're not some Taiwanese sweatshop. We don't produce junk." He wound the yo-yo up again, and now it spun smoothly. Sullivan made the yo-yo spin up and down as he looked out the window. He could see Lakeshore Drive and the glittering skyscrapers of Chicago. Most of the office buildings were half-lit. Other people staying late, working hard, just like him. The American dream. Put your ass in gear and keep it there. Or your neighbor will run away with your golden goose. He sent the yo-yo down again, trying for a trick he hadn't done in decades. Walking the dog. But the yo-yo lost its spin far too quickly. "Damn," Sullivan said to himself. "We make dolls that get weird and a yo-yo that can't cut the mustard." He turned to the computer terminal where Petzoid was tapping at the keyboard, a monkey playing with his new toy. Making Petzoid computer literate is a major achievement. His forte was getting coffee. Behind Petzoid was a wall of yo-yos, trains, battery-operated soldiers programmed to march and shoot, and good guy toys, some old, some new, everything from lunchboxes and pajamas to toy toll kits and the good guy video game, all whipped off store shelves immediately after the incident. A cornucopia of good guy goodies ready to roll off the production line. Petzoid said, "Ah!" Then he sat back and turned to Sullivan. "There, Mr. Sullivan, got your schedule for tomorrow right here. You have breakfast at 8 with the cereal people. They're very interested. Then breakfast at 9 with your attorney. Breakfast at 10 with a union rep. Lunch with your wife." Sullivan shook his head. "I thought we canceled that." Petzoid leaned forward, studying the screen. "Oh, yeah, that's right." Petzoid hit a key and removed the event. Sullivan, listening, walked to the window. A wall of black, dotted with the starlight glow from the office windows and streetlights. I could live here, Sullivan thought. Who needs a home when you have all this? The board meetings from 2 to 5, your hair treatments at 5:30, and the chiropractors at 6. Petzold paused. How's your back today, Mr. Sullivan? He hated it when Petzold tried to get personal. Don't ask, Sullivan said, looking out the windows, down at the miniaturized people on the street, tiny toy people darting around. He heard Petzold hit some keys, then click as he shut the computer off. Sullivan gave the yo-yo another spin, but it counter-levered left and right out of control. Petzold stood beside him, and he had the good guy doll under his arm. It was night. Just me and Petzold, he thought. But Dr. Patterson's warning hung in the room. Something foul and smelly, ruining his pleasure. And it made him think. Where is Andy Barclay? Is he out there? Whatever happened to the poor boy? Is he still having good guy nightmares? And his dear mother, did they ever release her from that mental home? She was a worse case than the son. Pathetic people, really. They nearly destroyed play pals. Petzold stood beside him, as if he were a peer. Sullivan shook his head. At least it was someone to talk to. You know, Petzold, the Barclay boy just turned 16. He's not so little anymore. Yes, sir. I updated his file myself. I've been following. Sullivan nodded. Well, I want to dump that file, Petzold. Personally. He turned to his toady. Put this thing behind us. Petzold nodded. Yes, sir. Sullivan smiled and then walked back to the terminal. He turned on the computer, but the screen was a blur. Sullivan dug out his reading glasses and put them on. From this terminal, Sullivan could reach the central files of the entire company. A list of branch offices, the entire worldwide PlayPals network, in fact. Sullivan hit some keys and brought up the menu called Personal Records. Another key brought a list of names, departments. Barclay, mom and son, were under the heading Good Guy Doll. He got the file. Mr. Sullivan? Petzold walked close to him, holding the box doll under his arm. Where do you want this? Sullivan waved a hand in the air. Just throw it anywhere, I don't care. Petzold threw the box, and Sullivan heard it land on the floor. The world spun around. The lights, the dots on the ceiling, the blackness outside all spinning, until Chucky inside his box landed hard on the floor. But there's no pain. That was always the great thing. No pain. Not right away. No. The feelings, the sensations took time to penetrate through the layers of plastic and metal, transforming his doll body into something living. If the process is ever completed, I'll be trapped forever, Chucky thought. Chucky moved his doll fingers. He closed them just a bit, just enough to be sure that he had control, that he could move his body. Then he stretched the fingers out. Okay, we're in business now, he thought, but the damn meter's running. Then he thought of what the fat cat Sullivan had said. Andy Barclay was 16. Amazing. Chucky ran several questions through his mind. Was it a problem? Will it still work? Can he still swap bodies with him? There were still things about this transformation that Chucky didn't understand. He let his chubby cheek smile go, relaxing his face, letting the contours of his face fall into a more natural state. There, he thought, feeling the comfortable sneer. That's better. Chucky listened and waited while the two men talked. Sullivan highlighted file Andy Barclay, and then he hit the enter key. He skimmed the file. Petzold cleared his throat. Well, Mr. Sullivan, if there's nothing else, I'm gonna get along. Sullivan turned and looked at Petzold. Fine, fine. He did nothing to hide the disapproving tone in his voice. "Well, you see, it's just my wife. She's expecting me," Petzold smiled. "It's our anniversary." How quaint, Sullivan thought. Sullivan stood up. "Fine, Petzold, wonderful. But remember, look out the window at all the office lights still on. There's always someone somewhere who's working just a few minutes later than you." Sullivan put a hand on Petzold's shoulder and gave it an unfriendly squeeze. Petzold gulped, an audible sound in the quiet room. Sullivan let his hand fall and then said, "Think about it." Petzold nodded. He backed up, scooping up his papers from the desk. "Yes, sir. I guess it's not too late. I guess I could bring something home." Petzold looked down at his papers.
"Times are tough. Unemployment is up. These are great days for the employer," Sullivan thought.
"I guess I could look over the Larrabee report after dinner." Petzold kept backing up. Yeah, I'll do that." He was at the door. Good night, Mr. Sullivan."
Sullivan turned away.
"Good night."
Sullivan heard the door shut, and now he was alone. A bit of an adjustment, not having someone to hop and skip to his every whim, but only a bit. He looked out the window, rubbing his chin. There were things he could do, other meetings to be set up. So much to see to, so that the good guy launch goes smoothly, and he thought of something. He wanted the earnings report before his breakfast meetings. He needed to prove to the cereal people that Good Guy cereal would leap off the shelves, that it was worth every damn penny he was going to squeeze out of them. Sullivan tapped the escape key, and the main menu came back. Petzold has the report. He was probably already back at his office or leaving the building. Sullivan ran to his door, opened it, and called out, "Petzold, wait!" He looked out into the dark offices, the maze of cubicles, the other executives' offices, the computer terminals, dark, sleeping. He heard something, the heavy whoosh of the elevator door shutting. "Petzold!" There was no answer. "Damn," thought Sullivan. He turned and went back into his office, shutting the door behind him. It was quiet. Too quiet. So Sullivan picked up the remote from the small coffee table in his office and turned on the television. It came on softly, inaudible. Sullivan used the remote to raise the volume before putting it down. The McNeil Lear report was on. Sullivan listened. Some congressman was wringing his hands about the country's military. Poor baby. Sullivan went to his liquor cabinet and poured himself a scotch. He opened the small refrigerator hidden in the wall and dug out some ice cubes. He took a sip, feeling warm and safe in his corporate cocoon. The scotch tasted wonderful, burning his tongue, the back of his throat. He swirled the ice cubes around. He turned back to the TV. The crybaby congressman was off and Jim Lear was giving the financial report. Figures came on the screen. The Dow Industrials were way up. Sullivan nodded. The economy was moving again. Maybe the 90s weren't going to be so nasty after all. He walked to a bank of switches on the wall and hit a button, lowering his office lights to a gentle glow, bordering on darkness. Then Sullivan took his drink to the window, swirling the cubes around, sipping it, the TV droning on soothingly in the background. He heard nothing else, until the TV went off. There was a small click, and then the TV went off. Sullivan wondered, is it a power failure? No, the lights are on. Maybe the TV is broken. Brand new set, though, a Sony 31-inch state-of-the-art. It couldn't be broken. He walked back to the coffee table to retrieve the remote. It wasn't there. His drink felt cold in his hand, icy cold. It must have fallen on the floor, he thought. Sure, the remote must have fallen, and Sullivan got down on his knees, the drink rattling in his hand. He didn't see the remote, not at first. But then he saw its dark outline on the other side of the table, lying on the floor. He thought, how the heck did it get there? Like someone dropped it or kicked it. Sullivan reached under the table, his fingers stretching towards the remote, his head leaning down, almost under the table. His back twisted in a funny way and he groaned. Oh, I'll pay for that. It felt like someone had jabbed a spike into my spine. He stretched another few inches and finally felt the remote. Gotcha, he said, pulling it back. He stood up, turning to the TV and taking a step. Then he heard the sound, a clicking sound that struck him as vaguely familiar. Something was clicking. Then he heard a rolling sound. He took a step, not looking down, not seeing. His feet slid out from underneath him. His arms flew out as he desperately tried to regain his balance. He looked like he was trying to fly. Only then did Sullivan get a quick glimpse of marbles, dozens of marbles rolling toward him, bouncing together, rolling under his feet. Sullivan went flying into the air, arms flapping. The remote, was it really so important to get that remote, he thought, went flying from his right hand, the drink glass flying from the other. He smacked down onto the floor, marbles pressing against his back. He heard a dull thud, the sound of his head smacking against the floor. A tidal wave, a tsunami of pain crashed over him. He moaned. He heard his drink glass smash against the wall, the expensive crystal shattering. Sullivan lay there, moaning, breathing heavily. Then he heard a police siren, a teeny tiny police siren, coming right at him. He turned his head and saw a remote control police car, its toy wheels burning rubber, coming right toward his head. Just a toy, he thought. No real danger, but it would hurt, smashing against my face right now. He sat up, twisting his back, driving another painful spike into his back. The police car pushed past him, bouncing on the marbles out of control. Sullivan heard more noises, giving him no time to think, to wonder what's going on here. Damn, what is going? He turned and saw a squad of soldiers marching against him, and a battery-operated colossal man, a giant. Police cars and fire trucks were darting left and right. All the toys from Petzoid shelves were armed for a state of emergency. Sullivan crouched. He tried to stand up, but he slipped on a marble. The soldiers advanced without any concern for their own safety. The room was suddenly filled with laughter. Over and over, a maniacal laugh. Someone was enjoying the show. It's got to be that laugh toy, Sullivan thought. That stupid, eerie laugh toy. Mocking me, what the... There was a train in the corner going round and round. The Good Guy Express, a small setup to show the big chain buyers. How about this for a toy, guys? How about it? Some neat train set, huh? The whistle blended with the mechanical laughter, the hooting and sirens. Sullivan stepped backward, still without a clue, as if this was a game show. Guess what's happening to you? Can you guess what's happening here? Because if you don't, you won't get the prize. No, you'll... There were voices. Voices? That should bring comfort. People talking. But these voices were high, scratchy voices like brats on amphetamine, jabbering away. Someone was sitting in his chair, hidden by its high back. He touched the back of the chair and crept close, knowing what it was from the conversation. Another step, listening to the babble.
My name is Larry. Hi, my name is Polly. Hey, wanna play? Hey, wanna play? I like to be hugged. I like to be hugged. Hi, my name is Larry. Hi, my name is Polly. Hey, wanna play?
Another step, now creeping closer to the chair, turning, watching the two Good Guy dolls talking to each other. Their heads turned to each other's eyes, blinking, each one responding to the other, trapped by the inane conversation, forced to respond forever and ever more. Sullivan's hand touched the arm of the chair. He had the beginning of a thought, the start of an idea, a theory, about what might be going on here. The dolls suggested it. The train's headlight cut through the room during each tight loop, catching the dolls' chubby-cheeked, freckled faces. Sullivan reached out and grabbed one doll's head, gingerly as if grabbing something very dangerous.
Hey, wanna...
The doll stopped in mid-phrase. The conversation, the surreal dialogue was interrupted. He waited. The dolls were still. Sullivan laughed. Damn, he said, nervous laughter. He reached out to grab the other doll's head. He touched it, feeling the cold plastic. He looked at them, studied them. No, he thought. A crazy theory, crazy. The dolls didn't move, couldn't move. He laughed again. Easy, Sully, you're losing it. Take it. He heard a yell, a squeal, a Good Guy's voice, but not from these two. The voice came from behind him, yelling, squealing. He turned, crouched before the seat. Another good guy was right behind Sullivan, and his face didn't look too friendly. It didn't have that trademark good guy smile, and this doll wasn't saying, "Wanna play?" Sullivan saw something else. The doll was waving Sullivan's beloved golf putter over his head. Sullivan let go of the arm of the chair, and just then the doll brought the club down, smashing Sullivan on his forehead. He went flying backward onto the marbles again, crushing a valiant soldier. A fire truck ran into his rump. He felt the wetness running off the top of his head, down his cheek. "I'm hurt," he thought. "I'm bleeding. This is bad. Very..." He scrambled to his knees and began crawling away, a frantic human crab skittering to his door, away from the toys, the dolls. "Almost there." The door only feet away. And after the door, he thought, "I can get to the elevator, down and..." A needle plunged into his back at the base of his spine. "Bullseye," he heard the good guy say. That wasn't one of the things it was programmed to say, not at all. Sullivan fell forward, his chin smacking onto the floor. The needle was stuck in his back. Sullivan's hands flailed at his back, searching for the needle. Chucky watched him. "Can't reach the dart, poor guy," he thought. "I'll have to do something about that." Chucky waddled closer to the big boss man of Play Pals, who was lying on the floor like a wounded animal. "Hey," Chucky thought, "I'm moving pretty well. Only a little stiff. Maybe the old plastic joints aren't quite broken in, but I'm moving." He saw a yo-yo on the coffee table and smiled when he saw it had his picture on it. He scooped the yo-yo off the coffee table. Old Sullivan seemed frozen on the floor. His get up and go got up and left. Chucky slipped the string onto his plastic finger. It was close. But no matter, Chucky gave the yo-yo a sharp spin. The yo-yo went down smoothly and then snapped up. "Hey, look at that. I still got it. After 8 goddamn years, I still got the moves." Then a bit of motion caught his glass eyes. Sullivan was crawling to his desk. So slowly now, his battery's on low. Probably gonna call for help. Still, he's making progress, and we can't have that now, can we? Thought Chucky. Chucky had another dart in his other hand. He ran beside Sullivan right next to him. The man kept looking forward. "Can't believe this is happening, right, babe? I know the feeling." He walked to Sullivan, making the yo-yo walk the dog, once, twice, before the string got all twisted up. "Gotta have these yo-yos retooled, pal. They're not working right." "No," Sullivan groaned. "No." The CEO reached up and grabbed the edges of his desk with his hands, pulling himself up, kneeling. Then, with Sullivan's hands only inches away from the phone, Chucky jammed the dart down on his right hand, pinning it to the desk. The man screamed. "Nasty sound," thought Chucky. "That must really hurt. But I don't want you breaking up the party. Not yet. I'm just starting to have fun. I've been out of circulation for a long time, pal. I've got some boogieing to do." Chucky let the yo-yo spiral down. He grabbed the string with both his hands. Sullivan was reaching for the phone with his free hand. Chucky said. And he wrapped the string around Sullivan's neck, and he pulled it tight. His fingers were touching the base of the phone, but then there was no air. Sullivan gasped, but the string was so tight, it cut into his skin, closing his throat. He tried to gasp, then to shake it off, but there was nothing. His fingers brushed the smooth plastic of the phone, pathetically. His lungs demanded oxygen. He could open his mouth, but nothing was going in. Sullivan saw white flashes, brilliant sparks of light. He felt the blood pounding in his brain. He smelled the plastic, the fresh new plastic of the good guy doll just behind him, holding the string tight. "It's all true," he thought. "It's all true." His tongue flapped, so much pain, and all he could think about was getting just one good gulp of air. That gulp of air never came. Sullivan's head smacked down onto his desk. Chucky studied the head. "I want to make sure that he's not playing possum," Chucky thought. He could be pretending. So he held the string tight for another minute, until he was sure there was nothing going on with this sucker. Then he let the string go loose. Chucky flexed his fingers. A job well done. "Just like the good old days," he thought. The toy police siren was warbling now, the battery running down. He climbed onto the desk. "Nothing like a strangulation to get the circulation flowing." He pushed Sullivan's head away. A small puddle of blood had dripped from his head wound onto the polished wooden desk. Chucky stepped into it, leaving footprints. "I'll have to do something about these later. Don't want no messy little good guy footprints around. No, sir." He turned, and standing on the desk, he could see his reflection in the giant glass window. And he wasn't happy at what he saw. He looked at that stupid good guy face, the blue overalls with the little tiny hammers and saws and planes and baseball bats. "Well, ain't I cute? And my tiny little good guy sneakers. God, and all those freckles. Even my freckles have fucking freckles," he thought. He opened his mouth and said, "I gotta get out of this goddamn body." Right. And there was only one way he could do that, before this transformation was complete. There was time. Chucky turned to the computer. The screen still displayed the main menu. "All right," Chucky said. "Let's find where you are, you little shit." He hit the key, scrolling past directories and lists, until he found what he was looking for. File Andy Barclay. Bingo, thought Chucky. Chucky grinned at the screen. In the dark room, he saw his face reflected back. "It's been 8 years, Andy. Let's see how you're doing now, bub. 'Cause your old pal Chucky is gonna pay you a visit." Chapter 5. Andy sat in the back of the yellow bus, ignored and not minding it. He looked out the window. He saw signs for towns he never heard of, and gas stations and quick marts offering everything from lotto tickets to foot-long hot dogs. He pushed his hair off his forehead. The bus rumbled along, catching every pothole, every crack in the damn highway. "I wish I wasn't here," Andy thought. "Anywhere but here."
"All right,"
he heard the boy next to him squeal. The little kid, what was he, 7, 8, was playing a handheld video game, pushing the buttons wildly. "He's in hog heaven," Andy thought, "and he doesn't even seem to be nervous about where we're heading."
"I made the third level excellent," the kid said.
He turned and caught Andy looking at the game. The little kid smiled at him. Andy nodded and smiled back.
"Hey, I just got to the third level. Never did that before."
Andy nodded. "Very nice." The bus lurched. Everyone's brains were getting a real good shaking. Andy started to turn away.
"Hey, what did you say your name was?"
Andy turned back. "It's Andy." The boy made a face.
"We only go by last names at Kent."
Kent Military School. A few minutes ago, Andy had seen a sign announcing that the school was only 5 miles away. Kent Military School. "Isn't life wonderful?" thought Andy. "Barclay," Andy said.
"My name's Tyler."
The kid held up his Game Boy. "I used to like video games," Andy thought. "I remember I had one of the first Nintendos before all my friends. Even though Mom couldn't afford to buy me a lot of games, still, I had some. I had Super Mario Brothers, and I had Good Guy Adventures. Help the good guy get out of the haunted house." Boy, did they have that one wrong. The kid dangled his Game Boy.
"You want to play me, Barclay?"
Andy shook his head. The bus hit another hole and groaned as it rattled forward.
"Come on, Barclay. I'll give you a 10-point lead. What do you say?"
Andy shook his head, looking away from the kid and turning back to the window. He looked at the farmland, dotted with cows chewing their crud as they watched the yellow bus roll by. Andy expected Tyler to keep nagging him, but instead there was silence, and when Andy risked looking back at the kid, he seemed intent on playing his game. But Andy also saw something else. "I shut him down," Andy thought. "I stepped on the little brat." He shook his head, annoyed at himself for being such a turd. "Hey, Tyler." The kid kept his head down, cautious. "You've been at Kent a long time?" Tyler let his eyes drift away from the game screen. 2 years. Andy smiled at him. 2 years and he's only like 7? Poor kid's been in military school since he was 5, 6? Then, with Andy still looking at him, Tyler smiled. "It's not bad, I'm used to it. You know, when I first came to Kent..." Tyler lowered his voice, trusting Andy, not wanting anyone else to hear. "I really missed my dad, a lot. But he always told me that soldiers don't cry, so I didn't. Not too much, anyway. And I got used to it." "I guess you can get used to anything," thought Andy. "I'm 16 and I feel like I'm going to prison. This kid's got a better attitude than I do." Andy sniffed the air, but all he could smell was bus exhaust seeping in through the open windows, through the cracks in the floor. And he thought, "Tyler's about the same age I was, the same age as when it all started. My problems with Chucky." He felt bad for himself then, looking at Tyler's shining black face. So brave. He thought about himself whenever he was 8, fighting a doll that wanted to take his body, and no one believed him. "They still don't believe me," thought Andy. "If only I had a dad," Andy thought. "Maybe that might have made a difference." "Did you just spend the weekend with your dad?" Tyler shook his head, and he went back to his game. "Wrong question," Andy guessed. Tyler made a face, pressing his lips together, as if it was no big deal.
"Nah, he's stationed in Japan. He says he'll bring me there someday. No, I was staying with my cousins."
The game machine made a funny beeping sound. Tyler just lost this round, but he didn't care.
"I stayed with my cousins. Man, what a bunch of geeks. I hated it.
I'm glad I'm going back to Kent."
"What about your mom, kid?" Wanting to say, "I haven't seen my mom in a long time. The doctors say it wouldn't be therapeutic. She's making so much progress because they don't believe her either. They don't believe that she saw Chucky come to life. Or believe Kyle, for that matter. God, whatever happened to her? She had a bad reputation before she ever hooked up with Chucky and me. Whatever happened to her?"
"My mom? She went to heaven whenever I was just a little kid. Me and my dad are on our own. He says she watches us, though, that she can see how good I'm doing."
Tyler turned away.
"How good I'm doing on my own?"
"You're pretty young to be out on your own, kid." Tyler scrunched up his face indignantly. The look on his face was so stern, Andy almost had to laugh.
"I'm 7 and a half. That's not so young."
Andy nodded. "If this rugrat can face Kent, then I can." He turned back to the window. Then the bus passed a sign. Kent Military School, 1 mile. Just ahead. The bus started climbing a hill, groaning, fighting its way sluggishly up the hill. "Not so young, for a lot of things." "No," Andy said. "I guess not." The dreams had never stopped. Doctors told Andy that the dreams would end, and they never did. And long ago, Andy thought he figured out why. The dreams didn't stop because everyone told him that it all never happened, but he knew that it had. It was just a little difference of opinion. And some nights, he dreamed that he was in his apartment with his mom when it was just the two of them, celebrating Christmas, getting each other presents, sharing ice cream or a deep-dish pizza from Tonio's. Mom worked hard so that Andy could have things, even popular, expensive things, things like the good guy doll. And he would relive the battle in the apartment, Chucky coming after him, mumbling those words that Andy never forgot. "Ah, de dui dembela, give me the power, I beg of you." His mom had saved him, but in the dream, sometimes his mom was too late. When Andy opens his eyes and looks down, he sees the blue overalls, the good guy sneakers. And when he looks up to a mirror, he sees himself with Chucky's maniacal grin. And he whispers, "I'm you, buddy boy.
I'm you.
Hey, Tyler said, and the vision vanished away, melting from some screen inside his mind. Hey, I got something you might like. Andy turned back to Tyler. The kid dug in his pants pocket. He took something out and then extended his hand to Andy. Andy stuck out his hand. What? What is it? Tyler put it into his hand, and Andy saw a compact pocket knife with just one blade. Go on, Tyler said. It's yours. Andy shook his head. No, sorry, Tyler, but I can't take your knife. He started to give the boy back the pocket knife, but Tyler shook his head. Go ahead, Barkley. I got lots of them. My dad sends them to me from Taiwan. I don't need this one. Andy felt the knife in the palm of his hand. He didn't want to slap the kid down again. What the hell, it's a gift. Take it, he thought. He smiled. He opened the knife, exposing the blade. It was sharp, silvery. This was no dull scout knife. Andy let his thumb touch the blade. A bit of pressure, and it would easily cut his skin. Andy looked up. Hey, thanks, Tyler. Sure. You know, my dad says a good soldier is always prepared. You should always have a weapon. Okay, a 7-year-old Rambo, Andy thought. There were shouts from the other kids on the bus. Andy looked up and saw a sign that said Kent Military School. Don't worry, Barkley, Tyler said. You'll learn the ropes. And Andy nodded as the bus entered the gate to the school grounds. The bus chugged past the open gate. Andy saw two cadets in full uniform standing guard. As if we were entering Fort Knox, Andy thought, or the Land of Oz. I may not be able to deal with all of this. To the right, he saw more cadets, a mixture of boys and girls standing beside two trees. He saw a girl, dark-haired, very pretty, tightening a rope suspended between the two trees. That's Da Silva, Tyler said. She's nice to me. Co-ed military school. Things could be worse, Andy thought, as he watched Da Silva demonstrate how to cross the rope bridge, shimmying with hands and feet. She was pretty, but she also looked like one tough cookie. The bus veered right and a giant field appeared, dotted with clusters of cadets, some marching, some climbing wood walls covered with rope netting. Drummers were marching in a line, beating out a rhythm. The place looked ready for war. Andy saw a big stone building faced with heavy columns and windows that seemed to stretch almost 2 floors in height. What's that? Andy asked.
That's the administration building. Hey, that's where Colonel Cochran's office is.
What? No general?
Andy laughed, but Tyler said, He's a nice man. I like him. You'll probably meet him first thing.
Hey, your recommendation is good enough for me, kid. The bus passed the administration building and moved next to a row of boxy buildings, the cadets' dorms. Finally, the bus stopped. The brakes screamed out in protest. There was a whoosh, and the doors finally opened. Everyone in the front of the bus stood up and started streaming out. Andy stood up next to Tyler, towering over him.
Let me know if you need any help, Tyler said.
Andy smiled at him. Thanks, Andy said, forcing himself to sound as earnest as possible. I will.
Okay/aholics, this has been chapters 4 and 5 of Child's Play 3.
Hope everybody's enjoying this book so far as much as I am. Of course, I always love the scene where Sullivan finally gets what's coming to him. And he gets what's coming to him at the hands of Chucky. And I love how the book explains the scene better and puts us in his head as he's slowly coming to terms with what's going on. That the kid wasn't lying, the mom wasn't lying, the doll really did come to life. And the way the author wrote that scene, I just love it, because that fear is just building and building in Sullivan, because he's slowly putting the pieces together before Chucky makes his big reveal that, you know, this doll is here, this doll is responsible for what's going on. And then when Chucky does finally make his appearance, man, you know, Sullivan is, I'm surprised the writer didn't say that Sullivan needed the change of underwear. But yeah, I really enjoyed the way that scene was written. Very visual, very suspenseful, the way it was written with him putting his hand under the coffee table, you know, and everything to pick up the TV remotes. Really enjoyed that scene. The line, "Nothing like a strangulation to get the circulation flowing," never gets old. Can hear that line 100 times. One of my favorite Chucky lines. But we followed that chapter up with, oh, yeah, one second. I always found it funny that Chucky said he's been out of it for 8 goddamn years or whatever, but he went straight to that computer and started working it like a pro, you know? At least that's the way it looked in the movie. At least on here, you know, Sullivan had already brought up Andy's file and everything, so maybe Chucky just got lucky. But I always thought that was kind of weird, you know, that Chucky, you know, been dormant for 8 years. You know, computers changed a lot in those 8 years, even if the movie, you know, didn't really take 8 years to be made, so the technology wasn't the same as it really ended up being 8 years later. Anyways, it's just a movie. I've got to suspend reality a little bit. But it was always just like a little quirky thing of that scene I always kind of laughed about. You hear those cars going by? I have to stop and start so many times during recording these narrations. It's crazy. But then we got the next chapter. And this was like a deleted scene from the movie or something, because Andy is on a bus on his way to Kent, and he has this whole scene with Tyler. And it really gives us a really good idea of Tyler's character. I mean, he's already a kid. Some people said he was annoying in the movie. I always thought he was a sweet kid in a tough situation. Like, I always felt bad watching it when the Colonel Cochran guy takes the good guy doll away from him. I mean, on one hand, thank God he took the doll away from him, because they were almost done playing Hide the Soul. But on the other hand, it was just like, damn, dude, his mom's died, his dad's in the military, sticking this kid in the school. You know, give him a break. He's not even a teenager yet. He's a little kid. Let him be a kid. But I like what the author did there, getting us familiar with him and a little more than we do so in the movie. And, you know, the early roots of him and Andy's friendship. So, yeah, we are ready to rock and roll at Kent Military School. I'll be back very soon with the next chapter or so of Child's Play 3. And hopefully this book keeps on pumping out the little extras. I love it when a novelization gives us more insight to characters' minds, extra scenes, you know, longer scenes than we saw in the movie, expanded scenes. Let me know what you guys think of this book so far, what you thought of the chapters tonight, and I'll see you soon with more of Child's Play 3. Until then, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80 slasher librarian saying thanks for listening, thanks for subscribing, don't forget to click that like button, and you can't keep a good guy down. Have a great night, everybody.
There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. You want it darker? We kill the flame. They're lining up the prisoners and the guards are taking aim. I struggled with some demons, they were middle class and tame. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? Darker. We kill the flame.